Hello students, so like I told you in the previous class on molecular plant pathology, for an infection to occur, there has to be interaction between the host and the pathogen or the organism that is going to cause the infection or cause the disease. Now these host-pathogen interactions or host-pathogen relationships is what we are going to talk about in today's class. So under this, under the host-pathogen interaction or relationship, there are four basic processes. The first one is germination of the spores. Now, if it is the seed of a parasitic plant or the spore of a fungus, it has to first undergo germination before it can establish an infection. On the other hand, all pathogens which are in the vegetative state are capable of initiating an infection immediately. So, if it is in the form of a spore or in the form of a seed of a parasitic plant, it has to first undergo germination. And to undergo germination, there are certain prerequisites. It requires a favorable temperature, the moisture should be very high, so the relative humidity should be more, and the environmental conditions should favor the germination of the spore. Now, when the spore germinates, it forms a germ tube, and this germ tube is the end or the part of the organism, the pathogen, which is going to enter inside the plant or enter into the plant tissue, causing an infection. Now, propagules, that is the spores or the vegetative hypha, or in the case of bacteria, the cell itself, these propagules or these components which cause a disease, which are propagated, which are dispersed by the organism, produce mucilaginous materials which help the organism to adhere or to stick onto the surface of the host. And once the pathogen is in the vicinity of a potential host or a plant root if it is in the soil, subsequently the pathogen will locate the host and penetrate, depending on the production of some signals or depending on the production of some chemical components by the plant. So this is what we are going to study about under recognition and entry of pathogens. How the plants produce some signals or produce some chemicals which can attract the organism. In some cases it can repel the organism, but it helps the organism to locate the host. Once it locates the host, with the help of its mucilaginous matrix, it is going to stick or adhere onto the surface of the plant, and finally it is going to penetrate inside. So these steps which I have just told you can be divided into three parts, that is pre-penetration, adhesion and penetration. So coming to the phase, that is the pre-penetration phase. Now this is the first prerequisite. The organism has to locate the host. That is what happens in the pre-penetration phase. So this can be either random or it can be with respect to certain adaptations to locate the host. Now if it is a random pre-penetration, it is based on chance contact. It may happen or it may not happen, and the successful contact will depend on the number of pathogens. So higher the number of pathogens, there are at least some chances that it will land on the host or it will be able to locate the host. For example, the fungal spores which are airborne or which are released by the phytopathogenic fungi, there will be so many spores that based on total randomness or it's based on total chance that a few of these spores can go and fall on a particular host. So this is called random pre-penetration. It is not in response to any signal. It is just because the number of the microorganisms is very high or the load is very high. So it enables the organism to go and locate the host by chance. That is what is called as random event of pre-penetration. Another example is the phytopathogenic bacteria or the bacteria which cause the plant disease. These are blown or they are splashed when the wind blows or when the water is falling or when there is rain. These are splashed from one place to another. So here again, it is just based on chance. It is just based on randomness. There is no selective mechanism by which the organism is locating the host. The second type is the presence of adaptations to a particular host. So in this case, the organism can show several adaptations to a particular signal. Now, examples for these are zoospores of the root pathogens like Pythium or Phytophthora swim along a concentration gradient towards the plant roots which are releasing sugars or amino acids. So the roots will release these sugars or amino acids as a normal method of their growth, and to this, identifying this, these pathogens are going to move. Another example is the sclerotia of the organism Sclerotium sepivorum. The dormant sclerotia will germinate in response to certain compounds, certain sulfur compounds which are released by onion plants or similar other plants. So here again it is with respect to certain signals, certain sulfur compounds which are being released by the onion plants. Which means that when I say it is in adaptation to a particular host, this means that the pre-penetration phase can be either different in the case of soil and on a host surface, that is on the aerial surface. So let us first talk about the pre-penetration phase, which is seen in case of soil organisms. Now in the soil, especially in the rhizosphere, the pathogens are influenced by whatever compounds are exuded by the plant root. So the plant root will release n number of compounds which are going to attract the organisms in some ways, and in other cases it is going to repel some other organisms. So we are talking about the way attraction happens because we want to know how pathogen is locating the host. Now either the motile stages of the pathogen can be attracted or, like I said, repelled. And one more thing that can happen is sessile propagules or dormant propagules which are present in the soil can get germinated. That means their germination can be either stimulated or inhibited by the compounds that are released by the roots or by the different compounds that are released by the plants. Either germination can happen or the motile stages of the pathogen can move towards the plant. So under the pre-penetration phase that is seen in soil, there are two types that can happen. One is chemotaxis, that is what I told you, where the zoospores of the fungus keep moving towards a particular plant, or say it is motile bacteria, they move towards the plant. Or the other thing that can happen is germination can take place, or the germination stimulated because of these compounds that are released by the root. Now examples of these are diazine or genistein, which is released by the roots of soya bean, that are going to attract the zoospores of Phytophthora pangasperma. Or we have cochleophyllin A, which is released by the roots of spinach, that attracts the zoospores of Ephinomyces cochleoides. Or another example is isovaleraldehyde, which is released by cinnamon roots, which will attract the zoospores of Phytophthora palmivora and even Phytophthora cinnamony. Or there is acetosyringone, which is released by tobacco roots, which will attract the Agrobacterium tumefaciens. So in all of these cases, if you see, there is chemotaxis, which means there is movement of the zoospores of these organisms or fungi towards the roots in response to a chemical that is released by the roots. The examples of the chemicals are diazine, genistein, cochleophyllin, isovaleraldehyde and acetosyringone. The second process that can happen in the soil under pre-penetration is encystment and germination, which means once the zoospores arrive on the root surface, they get encysted, they get cysted, and this is followed by germination of that particular cyst to form a germ tube. So once they come or they fall on a root surface, now their job is to get encysted and then undergo germination to form a germ tube. This process can be stimulated by the compounds that are released by the roots of some plants. So examples for these are glutamic acid and aspartic acid, which are released by the roots of several plants, which has shown to help in not only encystment and germination of Pythium affani dermatum, but also in the taxis or the movement of the organism towards the particular plant. Then we have diazine and genistein, which I also gave as examples here, which is helping in the encystment and germination of Phytophthora megasperma. And we have naringenin, which is helping in the encystment and germination of Fusarium solani, Formae specialis cucurbitae. So these are all examples of compounds that are released by the roots of the plant, which help the organism to encyst and germinate. Now this was in the soil, but we also have fungi, or we also have bacteria or pathogens which are present on the host surface in the aerial parts of the plant, or basically they are airborne pathogens. So in case of some root pathogens, the stimuli for spore germination or for the hypha to extend, hyphal extension, or the formation of apressorium, I'll tell you what an apressorium is in the next few slides, or attachment of the spore, all of this is provided by certain stimuli. So what are the stimuli that are seen in case of host surface? The first stimulus that is seen is hydrophobicity and hardness. Hydrophobicity is the characteristic or property of water repulsion, and hardness is with respect to the surface. So it is seen that higher the hydrophobicity of a surface, whether it is smooth or rough, higher the hydrophobicity of a surface, faster is the appressoria formation by the particular pathogen. So more is the hydrophobicity of that particular surface, more is the repulsion of water by that surface, faster is the appressoria formation by the fungal pathogen. Also, if the surface of a particular plant has been scratched or wounded due to any reason, if it is a scratched surface, even if it was initially smooth and it has been scratched in places, it is seen that appressoria will start developing quickly irrespective of the hydrophobicity, which means to say hardness is an important factor for the organisms to establish an infection or for the organisms to show a successful pre-penetration phase. Apart from hardness, hydrophobicity is also important, hydrophobicity of that particular plant surface. The second important factor or the second stimulus is the chemical signal. So there are several chemicals which are released from the host plant which will stimulate the germination or the extension of the hypha. So the spore, once it falls on the host surface, how it is getting germinated, whether it will get germinated, how long will it take the organism to extend the hypha, all that can be also stimulated by chemical signals. What are the different chemicals which are signaling or which are stimulating the germination? It can be waxes, which are a source of several nutrients, or it can be ethylene, which is actually a ripening hormone, alkynyl cysteine sulfoxide, or choline, glycine, betaine. All of these are compounds which are responsible for stimulation of the fungal spores or even the bacterial cells. So these organisms are, or the pathogens are, stimulated when they are airborne and fall on a host surface. They are stimulated by these compounds that are released by the particular plant. The third characteristic is the topographical features, which again means the surface of that particular, how the topography of that surface is, or what is the structure of that surface. So in the plant surface, especially we talk about stomata over here, because all plants will have the stomata. There are fungi like Rhizoctonia or rust fungi, which look for a stomata or which aggregate near the stomata and lead to or cause the formation of appressoria and infection peg. So usually stomata is one of the topographical features of a plant that is prone to infection. Many pathogens enter through the stomata because this is one feature that stimulates the fungal aggregation or stimulates the appressoria formation or the formation of infection pegs. So what we have done now, till now, is the pre-penetration phase. Pre-penetration phase is the first phase under recognition and entry of pathogens. Pre-penetration phase is, in simple words, the location of a host. So the location of host could be random or it could be an adaptation to a particular signal released by the plant. The location of a host in soil is different, and in case of a host surface which is airborne, it is different. In soil, location of host is mainly done by chemotaxis, where the chemicals are released and the organism moves towards the plant. Or the second way is by encystment and germination, wherein the chemicals are released and the organism germinates in response to that particular signal. On the host surface, that is for airborne pathogens, the signals are different. It can be chemical signal, but apart from that, it depends on the surface of the host. How is it shaped? That comes under the topographical feature. What is the hydrophobicity of the surface and what is the hardness of the surface? This is what is involved, or this is what is encompassing the pre-penetration. Moving on to the next phase, that is the adhesion phase. So once the organisms have located their host, once the organisms have located the plant, now the pathogen's propagules have to be effectively adhered onto the host surface. They should not be washed away. They have to stick over there. They have to stay over there. So for the adhesion, some of the particles which help, or the compounds which help, mainly are adhesins. These are molecules that aid or help the microbe to attach. Or the extracellular matrix of the of certain spores, not all spores, certain spores, example in pyricularia, this extracellular matrix will help the pathogen to bind to the host cuticle and prevent desiccation. In pyricularia, it's especially important. This is an organism which causes blast disease of rice. It is pyricularia oryzae. This organism produces a mucilage drop on the conidia. Now, it makes sure that with the help of this mucilage drop, it is sticky and it helps the organism to adhere onto the surface of the plant. There are also electrostatic mechanisms which help the organism to adhere. So, adhesion is stimulated or adhesion is brought about by adhesins or the extracellular substances, mucilaginous material which is released by some of the organisms and by electrostatic mechanisms. These are the three ways in which the organism is adhering onto the host surface. So, now it has located the host, it has stuck or it has attached itself to the host. Now, penetration and entry. Now, after pre-penetration and adhesion, the organism has to now get inside. It has to pass through the external protective layers of the host, like cuticular wax or the cuticle, pectin, cell wall. All of these layers now have to be passed through for the organism to get inside and establish an infection. So, this is possible, or penetration is possible by three ways. Usually, it is seen that pathogens will follow either one of the three ways. It can be entry through artificial openings, or entry through natural openings, or mechanical force, that is by direct. So let us deal with each one in detail. Now, you see here, this is entry through artificial openings. Now, artificial openings, when we say, it means that it is not an opening that is normally found in a plant. It has happened due to some event. What are these artificial openings? Either they can be wounds or they can be some lesions. Now, what are the wounds? Wounds are the physical damage that is caused by the pests, or it can be caused due to self-infliction. That is, whenever there is emergence of a lateral root, there can be some crack that is formed. You can see over here in the second picture. So, we have some lateral roots that are formed, and these, when the lateral root comes out, at that point there is some wound that is caused to the external surface of the plant. Through such wounds, or where there are wounds that are caused by some kind of mechanical damage, when the humans are tilling the land, or any kind of damage, or by nematodes, when such damages happen, those wounds or those traumatic infections are the ones which aid the pathogen to enter inside. So, these are very, very common mode of entry for weak as well as strong pathogens. Love to get inside through wounds. And the main reason being, nematodes will create tunnels in the roots, which will lead to deeper infection by other organisms. So, the other organisms will enter the xylem phloem easily, because now there are tunnels which have opened up the root. Organisms which enter through wounds include Fusarium, Sclerotinia, Phytophthora, Verticillium. There are many, but the organisms, these are some of the common ones which enter through wounds. Through artificial openings, we also have lesions. Now, lesions are caused by a primary infection. So, there must be some organism which has caused a primary infection. You can see over here, some other organism has caused the primary infection, leading to a wound, and this leads to, or this helps the secondary infection organisms or secondary invaders to enter inside. So, the two types of artificial openings can be either through wounds, which are created due to physical damage, or through pests, or through natural cracks that are caused by self-infliction. Either it can enter through wounds or it can enter through lesions. Lesions are some kind of tissue formations that are formed due to a primary infection. So, these are dead tissues which are caused due to primary infection, and this acts as an entry point for secondary invaders. These are the artificial openings. For natural openings, there are mainly three types of natural openings. Either the organism can enter through the stomata, or it can enter through lenticels, or through hydatids. Now, stomata and lenticels are structures that are found, or they are pores that are found for gas exchange mainly. Stomata are present for gas exchange on the leaves, on the underside of leaves, whereas lenticels are present for gas exchange on the fruits and on the twigs or stems of the plant. So stomata is a very important route of entry. Many of the bacteria and fungal zoospores enter through the stomata. The bacteria will enter passively. The zoospores may form an acrosoria or an infection peg. I'll show you in the next diagram how it forms an infection peg. But here you can see the spore has germinated and it has directly entered inside. This is to show a fungal pathogen. Even bacteria can enter inside very easily. Examples of organisms which enter through stomata include Pseudomonas, Solanaceae, Puccinia graminis, Plasma parabiticola. You have studied all of these in the previous unit on plant pathogens. Lenticels are again pores which are there for gas exchange, but the place they are located is different and their shape is different. They are lens shaped, that's why they are called as lenticels. So they are seen on the stems or twigs of the plant or on the fruits. Examples of organisms which use lenticels to get inside are Actinomyces, Penicillium expansum, Spongospora, Armillaria, etc. The third pore, natural opening through which the organisms get inside, is the hydathode. Hydathode is present on the tips and the margins of leaves. So you can see over here, this is the hydathode. These are basically to remove the excess water by guttation. That is what is shown here. So the excess water from the leaves is removed through guttation. This is the guttation water droplet. It happens that when the water droplet is actually being pushed out, it may also be sucked back inside, bringing the pathogen. That is also possible. So that is what is seen here. When the hydathode is open and the water is being sucked in, the pathogen also comes inside very easily. Examples are mainly bacteria like Xanthomonas and Erwinia. They are the ones which enter through hydathodes. So we have done the entry of organisms or penetration of organisms through artificial openings, which includes wounds and lesions, through natural openings, which includes stomata, lenticels and hydathodes. And the third one, direct penetration. Now, direct penetration can be either by the mechanical penetration or it can be through enzymes. Now, this is mainly seen. Direct penetration is mainly seen in case of fungi. It is more common in fungi. Mechanical penetration is where a mechanical pressure is applied on the host. We'll study its types in the next slide. Enzymes is where the organism releases several enzymes or it produces several enzymes like cellulase, pectinase, ligninase, cutinase. So it produces all of these enzymes which dissolve the surface structures of the plant or surface structures of the host. Examples of organisms which produce enzymes and get inside is Botrytis, Fusarium and Phanerochaete. Coming to here, there is a multiple infection, or you can see this is the aprosoria from which an infection peg has been produced. In case of infection cushion, infection pegs are being produced. So you can see here, this is the infection cushion, this is the runner hypha. From every infection cushion, there will be several infection hypha or infection peg that are released, which will penetrate inside the host, leading to multiple penetration. So it is able to attack the host faster. Something similar to that is also the infection plaque. Infection plaque is also a combination of hypha. It is basically a plate-like structure of mycelia, which again helps in acting as a compound aprosoria or as a thick aprosoria, helping in multiple infections. So cushion and plaque are similar. It is just differing in with respect to the name due to its shape. So cushion is more of an aggregation, that is from which pegs are produced, multiple pegs are produced. Plaque is a plate-like structure, multicellular plates of mycelium, which are acting as a compound aprosorium. This is seen in case of a fungus called as Tapacia. Then we have staccal formation. This is the last one. Staccal is a bullet-shaped structure that is released from the spore. So from the encysted spore, the germ tube will come out and there will be a bullet-shaped structure that is produced, which helps to inject the contents of the spore. So this bullet-shaped structure is, as it is bullet-shaped, it's easy for the organism to poke inside or to penetrate inside the host. Example of an organism which shows a staccal is Plasmodiophora. So this organism shows the formation of the bullet-shaped structure from the spore through which the contents are deposited inside. These are the different methods of penetration. So when we talk about penetration phase, when the organism has to enter inside, it can either enter through artificial openings like wounds and lesions, or it can enter through natural openings like stomata, lenticels and hydatids, or it can directly penetrate by applying mechanical pressure through these various fungal hyphal modifications, or it can produce enzymes which are going to help in dissolving the walls of the host. These are the different steps under host recognition and entry of pathogen. Thank you.